Hey everybody, welcome back to Altium Academy. I am your host, Zach Peterson. I'm also a local technical consultant for Altium. And today, we're going to be continuing to answer some viewer questions. And in fact, we got a great viewer question about BGA pad sizes. So in one of our previous videos, we were looking at BGAs, what they are, how to use them, how to route into them, fan out strategies, all that kind of stuff. But there's one thing that we didn't mention: what pad size should you use in your BGA footprint? That's what we're gonna look at today. Let's go ahead and get started. All right, so before we get started, let's take a look at that viewer question. Carlos writes, "You just skipped a crucial point about defining the size of the pad. Many manufacturers like Xilinx do not provide any recommendation for the land pattern in their data sheets. What to do then? I think you should cover that. There are calculators, IPC calculators, simulations, etc." Carlos, you're absolutely right. They don't always cover that. Some manufacturer data sheets do provide a sample land pattern. They may not call it the recommended land pattern, but they may provide something. In other cases, they don't give you anything. Sometimes they don't even show the land pattern. So what do you do? Well, let's go ahead and take a look at an example data sheet to see what data they might give you. And that's what you can use to then figure out the size of your BGA pads. Okay, so what I'm doing right now is I'm on Octopart. I'm just going to search BGA FPGA. You can see I've been on here previously looking for stuff. So in some BGA data sheets, the question is absolutely correct. They really don't give much on the packaging, or if they do, maybe it's in a totally different document. You just got to watch for that. So just as an example, look, if I search for ball, looking for ball out or ball size or something, I see nothing. If I search for like pad, there's a whole bunch of different results, but you can see it's all electrical data. There's nothing here on the physical data. I've already wrapped all the way back around. You know, footprint, they usually don't use that term. They'll use like land pattern. It's understandable that when you look at this, you know, you kind of wonder, hey, what am I supposed to do with the footprint here? Let's go look at another example. There's a certain network processor that I do know of that does show this particular land pattern, or at least some data that you can use to get the land pattern. Actually, let's just go with this first result. Let's just take a look here. Okay, so in this NXP data sheet, if we scroll down, actually let's not scroll because there's 138 pages, let's search. So if we search for land, nothing comes up, search for ball. Okay, so here we go. So we have some packaging parameters here. What you see right here, ball pitch and ball diameter, those are the two pieces of information that you're gonna need. Now, the ball pitch is sometimes given in the description. The ball diameter is usually not given in the description. So the ball diameter, you're gonna have to look up from the packaging information somewhere. But you can actually use the ball diameter to size the pad that you're gonna need in your footprint. So as we saw in that data sheet, we can actually get a ball diameter most of the time from the data sheet and actually use that to get the pad size. If we have a ball diameter, what we're actually talking about is the size of the solder ball that sits on the bottom of the component. So if you look at the bottom of a BGA component, you're gonna see all these little balls of solder down here. And when this thing goes through reflow, these are going to become molten, and then they're gonna adhere to the pad. And depending on the size of the pad, that is going to give you enough surface here to cause this solder to then adhere to the pad and then create the strong bond that you want in order to get the component to sit on the board. So that's the whole idea here, is to size this pad diameter D properly so that you provide enough mechanical strength to get the BGA to sit on the board. So if my ball diameter is D, there's actually a good rule of thumb that lets you estimate what the pad size should be. A good rule of thumb, if you don't have access to IPC standards, is about 0.85D, or 85% of the ball diameter. So that's usually your starting point. And this can be an SMD pad, so a solder mask defined pad, or it can be an NSMD pad. Now, SMD pads, NSMD pads, you know, should you use them on big BGAs, should you use them on smaller BGAs? I'll cover that here momentarily. But before we get into using an SMD or versus NSMD pad, I wanna dig more into this ball diameter versus pad size issue, because this is actually standardized in the IPC standards. So the standard that actually deals with this is IPC 7351B. So this is the standard where you can find a table that actually details what pad sizes you should use for a given ball diameter. I'm gonna summarize some of that information here because it's actually a decent sized table, but you can use that data to figure out what your pad size should be. And when we talk about the pad size, this is the solderable area, meaning for an SMD pad, this is the amount that peaks out from the solder mask. So your pad size could actually be a bit larger, but when you actually look at the solder mask could actually terminate here and then hide some of that pad. So this is your solder mask defined pad. The other option is you leave a little bit of an opening here between the edge of the pad and the solder mask, and now the size of this copper land essentially defines the pad size. So you could have either case, but in actuality, it's not exactly 85% of this diameter. Let's take a look at that table real quick. I'm gonna show you some of those values and you can actually see how to do this. Okay, so here's the table for the IPC 7351B land patterns for BGAs. These dimensions here in the nominal ball diameter column are in millimeters. So this is the ball diameter. These ball diameters, you'll notice as they get smaller, they require a smaller land diameter. And what you'll find here is that there's a reduction value, and these reduction values are grouped with a land pattern density level. So you don't really need to know those per se. What's really important here is that you just group up a ball diameter with a nominal land diameter. This nominal land diameter is like an average, and it essentially accounts for any manufacturing tolerances. Now, there is allowed to be some tolerance or some variation in that land diameter, and you can apply this variation. So just as an example, for a ball diameter of 0.75 millimeters, you can go all the way up to 0.6 millimeters or all the way as small as 0.5 millimeters for your landing pad variation. And that will give you some freedom in terms of how you prepare your footprints for your components. Let's just consider an example here. Like if you need to have some more clearance between your pads and you want to allow some bigger traces or some bigger vias in between your pads, you can do that by opting for a smaller land pattern. So you can use the small end of this land variation. If you want to ensure greater mechanical strength or make sure that you have a large enough solder area to account for any misregistration or anything like this, then you could go with a larger size land. So basically this is the range of land values that you can go with that will allow you to comply with these IPC 7351B standards on land patterns. And it goes all the way down here to very small diameter BGA balls. So make sure that you save this table and use it yourself if you ever plan to actually go and design your own land patterns. Okay, everybody. So hopefully this shows you all of the information that you need to create your own land patterns for your own BGAs. Just note that when you need to create BGA land patterns, that can involve a lot of pads. And this is why programs like Altium Designer include a footprint wizard. What they will do is they will actually create a basic land pattern for your BGA for you based on a set of parameters that you enter. And you can be assured that that land pattern that you design with that wizard is gonna comply with these IPC standards that we just presented. Go check out that tool. It's included in Altium Designer, free to use. Other programs have similar tools, and there are also services where you can go online and you can actually get land patterns for different components from sites like Octopart, as well as I think sites like SnapEDA and UltraLibrarian will give you those land patterns for some components. If you're in Altium Designer, you can also look in the manufacturer part search panel. That will actually give you access to a lot of different footprints for different components. So go check there if you want to skip this process of creating a BGA land pattern. All right, everybody, that's it for today. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to leave a comment, leave a question in the comment section, and go ahead and send your questions over to YouTube at altium.com. We love getting your questions, and make sure to subscribe to the channel. And finally, don't forget to call your fabricator, folks.